So this idea of naive Bayes, where you have a network that has a label producing or conditionally producing a bunch of attribute values, is just a really cool and powerful idea. So one of the issues is that even though inference in general is a very difficult problem, it's, NP-hard to work out what these probabilities are. When you have a naive Bayes structure, it's cheap. It's the formula that we had on the previous slide. The number of parameters that you need to write down, again, even if you have a very large number of variables, it's not exponential in the number of variables, it's just linear. There's two probabilities for each of the attributes and one probability for the class. We can actually estimate these probabilities. So far, we've only been talking about Bayes nets not in a learning setting, but in a setting where we just write down what all the numbers are. We can actually very easily estimate these parameters. How would we do that? Well, the easy way to do it is you count. When you're trying to estimate the probability of a particular attribute value given a class, it's really just in your labeled data, how often do you have an example that has that attribute value in that class, and then divide by the number of times that you have that class at all, and that gives you the conditional probability. So this is, and in the case of infinite data, this is actually going to give you exactly the right number. It also connects this notion of inference that we've been talking about with classification, which is mostly what this mini course has been about. So that's really great to have a connection. It actually allows us to do all kinds of interesting things, like instead of only generating what the labels are, we can actually generate what attributes are. We can do inference on in any of these directions. And it turns out it's wildly successful empirically. So my understanding is that Google uses a tremendous amount of naive Bayes classification in what they do. If you have enough data, you can estimate these values really well, and naive Bayes is just remarkably good. So it's like unclear why we'd even have any other algorithms, right, Charles?
Well, there's no free lunch, but I got to say, there's this, as a famous man once said, it works in practice, but does it work in theory? And I'm trying to figure out how this can possibly work. So I notice it's called naive Bayes, and I think I know why now.
All right.
One is that it's naive, and in fact, painfully ridiculous to believe that the Bayesian net that you wrote up there in the upper right-hand corner represents the real world most of the time, right?
I see. And why is that?
Well, because what that network says is that all of the attributes are conditionally independent, given that you know the label. That just can't be true. We talked about this before, where we were using Bayesian inference to derive sum of squared errors, that it makes a very strong assumption about where your errors come from, and an even stronger assumption about where your errors don't come from. So you're not modeling any of the interrelationships between the different attributes, and that just doesn't seem right. So one question I have two. I'm gonna save the second one though. One question I have is, how in the world can it possibly be the case that this works in practice?
That's a good question. It does. Moving on.
No, that's not satisfying.
No?
Well, how about I give it a guess? Okay.
All
Now
right.
that I've yelled at you, why don't I give it a guess? So I think it comes back to the conversation we had in the previous slide when I was saying, well, we don't have to count, we don't care about probabilities. And you said we do care about probabilities because it was the question you asked, and that was fair. But once we're down to classification, the probabilities really don't matter, right? All that matters is that you get the right answer. So it's okay, I guess, if the probabilities you get are wrong, so long as they're sort of in the right direction, right? That you end up getting the right label as a result.
Yeah, that's a good point. That in fact, even though we're introducing this idea in the context of Bayesian inference, it might actually not be so good at that, even if it is particularly good at classification.
Ooh, actually, I think I have a good example. So here, write this down. So let's imagine there are four. Actually, you can use the network that you have up there, okay?
Good.
So let's say that the first attribute, I'm just going to call it A. And the second attribute, I'm going to call B. And let's say we're lucky, and our naive assumption is right, and they really are conditionally independent. But let's say the third attribute is actually just another way of writing down A. And the fourth attribute is just another way of writing down B. So clearly, there are interrelationships between the attributes, right? The third attribute is the first one. The fourth attribute is the second one. There's no way around that. And so you'd think naive Bayes would fail. But actually, looking at your equation right below there, where you're doing counting, I actually think it'll work just fine.
Why?
Because all you're really doing is double counting the sort of weight of attribute A, but you're also double counting the weight of attribute B, and they'll cancel each other out, and you'll get the right answer.
When you do the argmax.
When you do the argmax.
You get bad probabilities. The probabilities end up being kind of squared of what they are supposed to be, but that's okay because the ordering is preserved.
Right, exactly. And so even if you were unlucky and the fourth attribute wasn't B, but it was something else C, it doesn't matter if you double count A so long as it still gives you the right label. And you could imagine that if you have weak interrelationships or, you know, you have enough attributes and so on, that you would still get the right, you know, yes, this is the correct label, even if you got the probabilities wildly wrong. Okay, so I'm willing to believe that that could happen in practice.
Okay.
So, in fact, my guess is that Naive Bayes believes its answer too much, but it doesn't matter if it happens to be right.
All right. And did you have other issues with it?
So the second problem I have actually boils down to that that equation you wrote there. So it's really nice and neat that you can compute the probabilities of seeing an attribute given a value by just doing counting. But I don't have an infinite amount of data, right?
Not on a bad day, no.
No, or even on a good day, I usually don't have an infinite amount of data. So what if I'm unlucky enough that for some particular attribute value, I have never seen it paired with that label, V?
Right. So then that means this numerator will be zero.
Right.
So?
Well, that numerator is zero, but since the computation involves a product, by just having one attribute value that I've never seen before, I'm going to end up saying, well, the probability of that entire product, of seeing that value given a set of attributes, is also going to be zero. So one unseen attribute basically says it doesn't matter what else is going on, which seems a little weird, right? You think that if all the other attributes are screaming, yes, 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 it should be positive, that just because you haven't happened to have seen any examples of some other one single attribute, that shouldn't be enough to do veto.
Good point. So, in fact, that's not what people often do. People will often, what they call, smooth the probabilities by essentially initializing the count so that nothing is zero. Everything has a tiny little non-zero value in it. And there's smarter and less smart ways of doing that. But, no, you're absolutely right that zeroing out problem is a real thing, and you have to be a little bit careful.
Hey, I just had a thought. So if you have to do that, because if you don't do that, then you're believing your data too much. You're kind of overfitting.
Ooh, overfitting comes up again.
Oh, so bear with me on this, Michael. So if you're overfitting by believing the data and you're fixing it by being smooth, I usually spell it with a V, but whatever. If you fix it by being smooth, then you're making an assumption. There's a kind of inductive bias, right? You're saying that I go in with the assumption that they're sort of all things are at least mildly possible.
Good.
Huh.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
Okay. Naive Bayes is cool. You've convinced me.
Nice.